keep your blaster handy, the West is a dangerous place. Fight to survive as men turn to monsters and the dead rise on the Wild West Exodus Hub at beastsofwar.com. In a world controlled by massive corporations, a steady aim and split-second decisions are needed for your Megacon to complete its goals. Begin your missions at the Mercs Hub on beastsofwar.com.
Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of The Weekender. I'm Lloyd, I'm joined by John.
Hello.
Hello John. And I'm joined by Justin.
Hi everybody.
And we're going to talk all things gaming.
We're going to talk all things gaming.
Chalk. I think I said talk.
I heard chalk.
Possibly said chalk.
Ah well.
It's early.
He's getting hungry.
Chalk it up to experience.
See what you did there.
Very good. Right, so first up, I see on the running order here, John, is Team Yankee. I'm going to let you take control of this bit because you were chomping at the bit to talk about Team Yankee.
Yeah, because you remember a couple of weeks ago Warren was all World War III, what happens if we nuke Beasts of War?
Yes.
And never really talked much about Team Yankee at all, and I was sat there going, I don't want to talk about it. So after that episode, I had a member from the site Blue Sun get in touch with me. He's a long-term ex-tanky and stuff like that, and was really interested, and he recommended a couple of books. So he recommended, obviously, Team Yankee. I had to read that.
Yeah.
So that was an instant buy. He also recommended one called Chieftains, which is like World War III from the British perspective.
So hang on, is this if it actually kicked off?
Yeah, this is the whole thing behind Team Yankee. This is World War III gone hot, but not nuclear.
Okay.
So it's a lot of ground forces attacking and stuff, NATO and that.
Right, let me just, the two books, right, so there's Team Yankee.
Yeah.
Is that from an American perspective?
Yes.
Because it sounds like an American
it
perspective.
Is very much smack bang in the middle of it.
And then Chieftains is?
The British perspective.
Okay, and the Chieftain was a British tank
In
the 80s?
Mm-hmm.
Was it like there was like the main battle tank?
It was the main battle tank slowly being replaced by Challenger.
Okay. Are you going to horrify us? Should we all be running scared from World War III?
I've read Chieftains completely. I blasted through it in a week. It didn't last very long. Mm-hmm. And I've started reading Team Yankee. Chieftains is definitely a very gritty novel. Very dark, very scary. There is that overhanging sense of doom above everybody in it.
So they get the tone right, but what about the actual crew? Because we know every tank crew is insane.
Every tank crew
let me just stop you right.
Okay,
right.
Okay.
So is the book from the point of view of one particular tank crew?
Yes.
Right. That's what I'm gleaming from this conversation.
Oh,
right.
Sorry, we've...
Let's
bent my ear a couple of times.
Let's lay the groundwork.
Mm-hmm.
Chieftains about a tank crew in a Chieftain tank.
Yeah.
During World War III.
Yes.
The tank is where?
It's in Germany.
Okay, so it was on that sort of border waiting for it all to kick off.
Mm. Yep.
Go.
Okay. Team Yankee runs along the same lines.
Yes.
An American tank unit on a border area facing the Russians.
Yep.
So the novels both have that sort of build-up to it, that sort of uneasy peace that's going on at the border, and then all of a sudden everything goes mental and the Russians come across the border.
For someone like myself who obviously hasn't read the books, let's take Chieftains.
Right.
Does the novel revolve just around them in the tank? You bet, like Fury the movie, or does it revolve around other actions like aircraft coming? Does it describe other weapons of World War III or what?
Yeah, it describes a lot of the preparations NATO made for World War III. So they talk about the extensive minefields that are in front of them, the amount of air support they have behind them, the amount of air support the Russians throw in at the initial bat, and they talk about the dangers of artillery and stuff like that. There's a lot of different weapons that are talked about, especially the Russian attack helicopters.
Mm.
They do describe them in a lot of...
There's nothing weird and funky about this. This is all equipment that existed, yeah?
Yeah, the basis of both these novels is what we had in the 80s, thrown against what the Russians had in the 80s. You know, everything just went to pot and these two armies went at each other.
Right.
Which is probably why the whole Team Yankee thing suits Battlefront.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not weird. It is all still historical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I mean, like, you'll still have all the vehicles at the time, so yeah, they can go out and do the rivet counting if they want.
Yeah.
If they have to, yeah. But what I get from a sense from Team Yankee in general is more of an emotional side of things. It's more personal account rather than describing in any great detail the vehicles and the equipment and stuff.
Mm.
Even in Chieftains, they're sort of like, we love our tank, but that's a Russian airplane. Don't care what it is. It's shooting at us, you know, that sort of thing. So it's more of a personal account.
You get that from the guy you were talking to, Blue Sun's, wasn't it?
Blue Sun, yeah. He
said that he knew a driver who was very, very touchy about his tank.
Yeah, there was a lot of very particular crew members and stuff he had. Very good guy, very a lot of information. With more to talk to about him eventually.
Do we get nuked in these novels? Maybe that's giving it away for someone who hasn't read it. But you know, how can it be World War III if there's no nukes? Do they just know? They just don't go there.
Chieftains goes there.
Oh, okay.
But that's a spoiler to anyone that wants to read the novel. Things do get bad in Chieftains. Mm. Team Yankee, not too sure about. I've had a couple of spoilers thrown at me as well, and yeah. I wasn't happy about that, so I'm just going to read the novel.
I have to wonder for Battlefront's Team Yankee. Will they have nukes in it?
Yeah.
Right. But this is the thing that Warren said the first time he mentioned it. You can't go nuclear on a tabletop game, because once you go nuclear in a tabletop game, it's over.
I know. There was this game I loved on the Amiga, mm-hmm. possibly on the PC as well, mm-hmm. called Megalomania. Mm-hmm. Right? And you start as cavemen, mm-hmm. and you're chucking stones and sticks and stuff at each other.
Right, so there's the Amiga. So you're not chucking stones, you're chucking pixels.
Right, chucking pixels. And then you research, yeah. and then you move up to like chucking spears. Mm-hmm. Right. So you basically go from cavemen to like Romans, to like Saxons, to like modern...
Pixels to long pixels.
Yeah, so you end up in like in World War I with biplanes and stuff flying over, and you're starting dropping bombs.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's a race, it's an arms race. Mm-hmm. But there's a point where you get to like World War II, you breeze on through that, and then you get to like futuristic weapons. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, it's all over. And it literally says, there's a point where someone will launch a nuke, and the game just goes, it's all over! And you're trying to get the other commanders and stuff to be on your team,
yeah.
briefly.
Mm-hmm. Until you're ready to shiv them in the back.
The weirdest little voices, because like, there'll be a guy pop up on your screen from the other team, and he goes, do you want to be on my team?
That's a bit unusual.
And I loved it, right? Because yeah. there's a point where you could research past nuclear, mm-hmm. to a point where you ended up in this like sarcophagus. It's just a big black dome castle.
Yeah.
Right.
And if you got nuked, you were still alive. You basically had gone to the point where you encapsulated yourself in a nuke-free,
a nuke-proof area.
A nuke-proof area. Right. While everyone else nuked everybody. But it basically ended in, it's all over! And everyone's dead.
Yeah. Once things go nuclear, things tend to end pretty quickly.
Yeah, but that's where we come to my favorite genre myself, where it's post-apocalyptic.
So I guess you could do it on the tabletop, except that would be the game gone. You could race, I suppose.
You could have it as missions.
You couldn't nuke on the tabletop, though. You couldn't say, I'm dropping a nuke here, a strategic nuke, because as Warren described, a strategic nuke, based on the tabletop skill, would wipe it all out anyway.
Yes, it would be all
It's
over.
A delete button.
If you're going to have nukes and stuff, it would be like a race to see who can get to the nuke first.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it would sort of be like your mission counter. Yeah.
Or fighting in a nuclear environment would be an interesting one.
True.
Yeah. You'd have to do checks every time your tank or something gets hit. Check your NBC filters are still working. Check your air filtration stuff's right and all that.
That doesn't sound very exciting to me.
I know, but it's an added thing. Like if you take a wound, you might get irradiated and you're dead anyway. So it's like, oh, crap.
Yeah.
You know, but it's a very sort of once nuclear is pressed, things are finished.
Yeah. Nuclear is scary anyway. I was watching Horizon.
Right. Oh, don't watch Horizon. That is like the most... That documentary is designed to instill fear.
I had one of my favourite scientists on. He'd done stuff about... quantum physics and stuff a while back.
Okay,
but he was doing one about nuclear, mm-hmm. and it was all about nuclear waste and stuff, and he was talking about Sellafield, and he got permission to go into Sellafield and film inside it and mm-hmm. stuff, mm-hmm. and he was talking about Half-Life and stuff like that. And basically, it's really scary stuff, because in Sellafield... there's big, basically, swimming pools of water.
Mm. Yeah.
There's about 5 meters deep. And they just chucked all the nuclear waste into it.
Yeah.
And they're just relying on the 5 meters of water to stop people getting irradiated from the waste, because it has to get through the 5 meters of water. And when they were developing the British bomb, that's basically what they did. They just basically chucked all their waste and chucked it into a pool. Mm-hmm. Mm. A holding pool for nuclear waste. And now they're trying to clean it all up. They grind it up into something that looks like coffee granules.
Yeah.
And then they encase it in glass.
Yeah.
Because the stuff, they recycle some of it and turn it back into uranium and plutonium and stuff to be reused in the nuclear reactors and things. Yeah. But there's the nuclear waste, there's the leftovers they can't do anything with. They grind it up and they put it in glass. Mm-hmm. And they melt the glass so it basically just becomes the glass. And then they stick it in a big metal tube or a big metal cylinder and they seal that up. And then they put that down like a big chute. And they're just going to leave it there for thousands of years.
Why are we not collecting these things up and like firing them into space?
Well, you see, the scary one is really Chernobyl.
Well, yeah.
That's one that did go into a meltdown. You know, they actually built a casement over the top of it, but that wasn't enough. They're now having to build the second one over the top of it.
Well, there was one in England. It's Sellafield, isn't it?
Sellafield had a couple.
There was a reactor there that went on fire, and they were all sitting gobsmacked going, how can our reactor be on fire? And there's a big raging fire inside the reactor for 3 days before they flooded it.
Yeah.
Right? And in the documentary, we're talking about on all the nuclear waste was going up the chimney.
Yeah.
And out the chimney. Mm-hmm. At least it would have if some scientist hadn't insisted putting a filter on the top. And everyone's like, oh, you're nuts. We don't need this filter. But if you hadn't done it, the whole northwest of England would have just been irradiated and you wouldn't be living there now.
Right.
So but yeah, scary stuff.
Scary stuff.
Because the likes of, they're taking reactors and stuff apart and they're encasing them in concrete.
Yeah.
And then they're just storing them there and it says, in about 100 years time, we'll be able to open that.
Yeah.
Maybe.
100 years time. And then their other stuff, yeah, a few thousand years we'll be able to open that.
Yeah.
And you're just looking at the nuclear option. The nuclear option is so...
It's that one-way ticket to hell.
It really is, isn't it? I mean, when we're generating energy and we're generating waste, imagine what it'd be like if we just nuked everything.
Well, the question then is, John, what all do we have here? Because I'm seeing some other stuff on the running order here.
Yes, after Warren's little foray into the world of nuclear disasters, Battlefront started putting out some preview images of some of the models that are coming out. They done some infantry teams and stuff like that. Yeah. But what I have here is some previews for the air support units.
Okay.
And the artillery unit. So I believe we have an image of everything that we have coming out here, all the previews.
Yeah, this is the little composite image that I put together for this. Are we sure this is all Battlefront, yeah?
Yep, this is all Battlefront. This is all their previews that they've put out. Obviously, I've asked you to put in a couple of the novel covers as
well. Yeah, we've got the Chieftain cover and the Team Yankee cover.
Yep, so anyone that's actually looking for these novels, you can just pause the video, I guess, and just... Write down the names of the authors.
Yeah, quick question. Mm-hmm. Is that an A-10?
That is an A-10.
That is my favourite airplane of all time. Let me bring that up again.
Yeah.
Down the bottom there in the middle.
The A-10 Warthog.
The Warthog or the Thunderbolt 2. So cool.
See, during the flipping Iraq stuff, I just loved watching that plane going around, flying. It's just the coolest looking airplane.
It really is.
It's the actual way it's gun fires. Because you see the dirt being stitched up just going... And then you hear it after it's finished firing.
I don't know. I just love the look of the two big sort of... Is it jet engines?
Yeah, it's two big jet engines.
Sitting there just... Mm. It looks a bit Imperial Guardy, doesn't it?
It does a little bit. When you see it in those colours.
Just a smidge.
But yeah, so yes, we have the A-10.
Yeah.
It's going to be hilarious because anyone that has this in an American force is going to make the Russians cringe because these things are ultimate tank killers.
Speaking of the Russians, I'm gonna slaughter this. We have the Soviet Sukhoi.
The Sukhoi.
Su-25. Is that up in the top left?
Yes, that is the top left. That is one of their bomber ground attack aircraft.
Yeah, and then we have that cool looking chopper.
The chopper. We have the Hind. This is the Mi-24.
That's the Rambo chopper.
This is the Rambo chopper. It's an awesome chopper. Yeah. They still use versions of these things today, and they are terrifying looking. They're so bullish.
So the A-10's still in service today, isn't it?
that's the one that One and Dust looks a bit like, isn't it, fellas?
Bloody does. Quick question, John.
Yes.
Is it just me, or do the Russians persist with this idea that the Katyusha was a good idea?
The Katyusha was a good idea.
The rocket launcher.
Yeah. Yes. That thing.
Why would
it looks as if you fired it, it would spin on its side.
Why wouldn't that be a good idea? I've seen them fired, and it looks scary as hell.
Mm-hmm. Especially when you have a group of maybe 20 of them going off at the same time.
If I seen that driving to me, I would drive the other way.
If I seen
that firing, I'd be like, oh my goodness.
Well, if it was driving towards you, it wouldn't be firing, so you'd be safe.
Yes, but I'd be scared if it's driving towards me. I'd be even more scared if it fires.
See, here's the thing. If you saw that firing, the clever thing isn't to drive away from it. Then you're driving into the field of fire. You drive towards it, and then you're seeing it.
Get closer and get safe. So yeah, that's the BM-21. That's basically the Katyusha's grandson.
Mm.
The Katyusha was the first thing that started, then BM-21 came along.
Yeah.
The Americans...
Where's the Cobra helicopter?
Oh, you haven't put the Cobra... You haven't put the Cobra
Where's the Cobra? How can you miss the Cobra helicopter?
You missed the Cobra helicopter.
That shouldn't be, because I checked this against that, and it was correct at the time. Apologies.
It's the Cobra helicopter, Justin!
Can't get the stats.
How is that possible?
Apologies.
Cannot get the stats.
Wait. Shake that head again there.
Apologies.
Cannot get the stuff.
Yes, there's a Cobra helicopter as well for the US.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we have a couple other American vehicles there. At the bottom left, that, I believe, is the ITV, which is like the anti-tank rocket launcher sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. I'm looking for this ITV on my list. Where's this ITV?
There's something else he hasn't put on the list there.
Hang on, I didn't make the list. I was given a set of images to work from.
He's taken stuff off by
accident. I will just point.
No, I haven't.
I will just point and you tell me, do we have it? Do we have it?
Do we have it? Let me see. Yes.
What's it called?
Or do we? Hang on.
Has everything just went to pot?
That is the M109 howitzer. That's
okay.
A 155mm howitzer.
Tucked in behind Luke.
Tucked in behind
Let me bring Luke. That up.
That is the ITV. That is the anti-tank rocket launcher.
Okay, And then up here?
Up here, that is the M113 mortar carrier.
This is so much easier.
Yeah.
Up there?
Up there is... the seat. We actually have the name of that. The 2S1... We call it the Carnation in NATO. Yeah. I can't pronounce
Gov's Dyka?
Hmm?
Gov's Dyka?
Yeah, whatever.
Let's slaughter another name. Anyway, that's sort of summing up. And these are all previews of releases that are coming for Team Yankee.
Yes.
From Battlefront.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Now, the cool thing about that is you can see that there's going to be a pretty wide range. They really seem to be going for it now.
There is rumors of the M113 in particular being a plastic kit. And when you see the pictures of it, that does look like a plastic kit.
Yeah.
Yes, that's, that one.
Yes, this one.
That does look like a plastic kit to me.
I will agree with that.
Because the other one, the Russian one that's across from it, looks more like their resin hybrid, I think. The tracks look like they're metal cast.
It'll be interesting to see what way they do this.
Yeah, exactly. What we haven't seen yet is any tanks.
Oh, I suppose, yeah, this is all our artillery and flyers, isn't it?
Yes, we've seen artillery so far, we've seen air support, and earlier they put out a preview for their infantry teams and their infantry transports.
Right.
So we've not seen the tank yet.
What are we expecting tank-wise, aside from Chieftain?
Oh, you beat me to it. I was going to say Chieftain!
If we get Chieftain, that's an interesting point, because Team Yankee is very much on the American perspective.
Right.
Now, unless...
Surely there'll be a British force in it.
I think that we will get Chieftains.
You think so?
They wouldn't cut off an entire force of collectability.
Yeah.
Just because it's called Team Yankee doesn't mean they have to stick to the book of Team Yankee.
And it's certainly just going to be a two-man fight.
I would assume.
I hope the Battlefront have read Chieftains.
Yeah.
And see how similar the two novels are and go, if we put a British faction in, that's going to make so many people happy because we're going to want Chieftains in it. We're going to want Challenger 1s in it because they mention Challenger 1s in Chieftains and I'm like, yes!
Well, was it just them sitting going, God damn it, we're in a Chieftain, why can't we have a Challenger?
Well, at the time, Challenger was only coming into service.
Mm.
So at one point, the Chieftain troop drives past a Challenger troop that sat in its firing position, but they never mention it again. It's like, oh, look, there's Challenger. Away we go.
Yeah, because if they introduce the British, probably the French or something as well, you will get the Harrier jump jet, wouldn't you? It's in the time period, isn't it?
Yeah, I think Harrier was just coming in.
Just coming in?
Abrams? Yeah. Oh, Abrams was in, yeah. That's what Team Yankee is. Team Yankee is a troop of Abrams.
Okay, I haven't read the book.
Hmm. But it's the early version when they still had a good gun in the British gun, not the German one.
Because you would have to have the British in to have Warren's favourite nuclear bomb in the Avro Vulcan.
Yes.
Because that's a British airplane, isn't
it? Yeah, we have to get the Vulcan in, definitely.
Yeah.
I would like to see that. Because they could use it as a conventional bomber in the game rather than just a nuke.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's plenty to look forward to. I want to see the tanks.
But they should be in there because it's going to be NATO
versus the Warsaw Pact.
Yes.
Mm. Yeah.
So they would be in there,
mm-hmm.
I would assume.
I certainly hope
looking forward to seeing it anyway. And looking forward to seeing tanks.
Yeah.
But I'm deadly happy to see this.
Yes, the A-10.
Absolutely. Straight in there with no messing about. There will be air units.
Mm-hmm.
There will be a big variety of units. Mm. We've got the Rambo chopper. Yeah. What more can we want? Well, we know what one we want. We want Harrier jump jets. We want Vulcans.
We want tanks.
We want tanks.
Lots of tanks. I will admit, though, when it comes out, I am not going NATO.
Oh, you're not going NATO?
I am going Warsaw Pact. I am going Russian.
Looks like that leaves me with the Americans.
You can have your Abrams if you want.
I don't know. You see, I'm already doing Russian in the dust stuff.
Mm.
But do I want to do Soviet type stuff again?
I think you could probably... You might like the British then.
You know, I might like
get
the British.
Get your Vulcans and stuff if they bring it out.
Actually, but you might mention it, yeah.
Can he weather at that scale?
Ooh.
Yeah, I have been...
That's a challenge.
I have been practicing my weathering techniques and stuff.
You have
on essentially a 1/48th scale model. Mm. Now the question is, will those weathering techniques work
at 15 mil?
At 15 mil?
Mm. Yeah, probably. You might just have to be.
Probably not.
You have to be a bit more subtle.
Probably they wouldn't.
Right.
I don't know.
So instead of just dumping the pot on top.
It doesn't matter on the tanks though, because you just cake them in the pigment powder anyway. It just looks good anyway. Mm.
But I don't cake it. Anyway, we're getting on to hobby stuff.
Yeah.
Right, I'm going to move us on. Mm-hmm. We've got some... I've been wandering around. You'll have seen it in the vlogs. We've been doing some rearranging and stuff at the studio. If you haven't seen the vlogs, join the backstage and check them out. Mm-hmm. What we now have is we have some dedicated gaming space set up permanently, not just for when boot camps and stuff happen. As part of that though, it's refocused me on thinking... We need to get terrain and stuff painted up. We have a good supply of terrain now.
Yeah.
In the videos, you'll see me looking at, going, there's tubs of trees, there's tubs of sci-fi, there's tubs of fantasy. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But
and
I want
all
more!
All our Star Wars minis.
You can never have enough. You want more terrain.
Well, it's like Warren always says, when it comes to terrain, more is more.
More is more. Yeah. I've been hunting around and opening the boxes to see what else there is. And this week, I was looking at this stuff going, you know what? We really need to get this stuff from MicroArt painted up. Mm-hmm. Behold! What am I looking at here, John? Will I change to the camera?
Yes. Yep. You're looking at, hang on, the City High Ground large building.
This is the large one.
I think this
is class looking stuff.
Now, I had initially thought this was going to be very fitting for Infinity, because when you see the pictures on the site, they're painted in that very sort of high contrasting color, but you disagree with that.
Well, it has the hexes and stuff, but when you look at them, they're really chunky looking. Mm-hmm. Mm. You know, I'll just try and give you a preview of the sides.
These could fit into something like Warzone quite well, I would say.
We have some painted pictures, and I'll show you in a minute. Take a note of these screens. Now, when I first whipped the terrain out, I didn't even realize they were screens. I know it's stupid on second glance looking at them. Going, of course they're screens. But if I cut to a painted image, I love the green effect that they've done on the screens.
It is very nice.
See, I don't know.
Now, it's Infinity-esque looking there because they've painted the hex pattern, big brash colours.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But if you don't do that, then I can't see why you wouldn't use this in 40K. So what,
would you do this something dark and gritty gunmetal?
Well, no. Probably, we've been doing a lot of green
and
stuff.
We've done camouflage stuff, with some of the other micro arts.
Although Kristen's saying he doesn't want another green set. Mm-hmm. He wants...
I don't know, I would rather just tie it in with everything.
You think it should be green as well?
I think it should be done in that nice camouflage because it's nice and generic and it can go into any faction.
I don't know. I'm tempted to agree, but I'm going to put in like a predator here for scale-wise. Because everyone looks at it and they go, oh, another building for Infinity. I'm going, no. Another building for 40K. Look, perfect.
Yeah.
Scale-wise for hiding that tank.
You might have a lot of people turn around and say, oh, it looks too Tau-esque.
I don't think so. And I'm coming around to this idea that Kristen has of painting poppy colours. Let's bring up the smaller brother.
Yeah.
What's this one, John?
That is the City High Ground Small Building. Mm. That's a very interesting naming convention there.
Oh, very exciting. Let me give you a look at that. Now, you may think, why is Lloyd showing us these buildings? But it's because I really like the hard foam stuff.
Yeah.
Mm. Well, it's...
I like the durability of it. Mm-hmm. Let me turn it over.
You're not having to worry too much about it.
And we've painted it up, and it's so easy just to open a tub and throw the stuff down.
Once you have it painted, you couldn't tell that it's just hard foam, or that it's even a single-piece model.
Now, very important question. Has Lloyd figured out where to put his flags yet?
No, not yet. And I'll give you another scale comparison. Mm-hmm. Perfect for hiding a predator behind.
Yeah.
Because one of the things I always do when we get to bits of terrain is I look and see what game systems this is going to be useful for. Do we have a picture of these smaller ones?
Yeah, I have a picture of these painted. Here it is here.
Mm-hmm.
There we go.
Yep.
Yeah, as you can see, again, they've gone for that poppy stuff, but...
Yeah, well, hang on. The soldier in front of that.
Yes.
What is that?
That's one of their own soldiers from MicroArt.
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay.
I don't think they ever expand... I think
they never used another company's model in their images. So.
Fair enough.
They have their own, but I don't know if they ever expanded the range. It comes with there's this weird...
That weird
spidery looking thing.
Carrier thing.
Which is kind of cool. Mm-hmm. But it got me back in the mood of searching for terrain, and I was browsing around our own website. Mm. And I came across a post from Ben talking about Zen Terrain.
Yeah.
And I thought, ooh, that's really cool. We have a picture of the Zen Terrain stuff. I'm looking specifically for the Habs, not this.
Well,
I'm looking for the Habs.
Well, you're talking about just the little houses. I have one image for that.
Mm-hmm. What? So, you have one image? Oh, you have lots of images. Yes, this stuff image. Here.
It's three in one.
I was browsing around the site and I came across this and I was looking at that going, what caught my attention was the overhangs and stuff.
You see, it's them taking a simple shape and putting the voids into it to make it look more complicated.
Do you have one with the overhangs and stuff?
I have a different building with overhangs on it, which is this.
Yeah, that's the building I didn't like very much at all.
Is it?
No, I'm just, I'm just kidding. No, but yeah, I was browsing around the range going, I haven't seen this end stuff before, and it's all really reasonably well priced.
Yeah.
What else is there? Hold on, let me bring that up big, just again before we go.
Yeah, well, you see, we've got this. It sort of looks almost like a corporate thing. Did you say it was a dice tower, John?
Yeah, they have it on the
They
site,
have like a dice tower. Yeah. I think you can roll the dice down it or something, it comes out.
Oh,
it's the mouth there, so
it needs to be
done. It goes in there,
yeah.
And I think it comes out there and into your wee tray.
I like that. That's kind of cool.
So you get terrain and dice tower in one.
Yeah, well, you've got the one that I tried to show you first, which is sort of like a little sushi bar type place,
yes.
Which I really like.
It's really funky.
Mm-hmm.
I like that. This stuff's all very Infinity-esque looking.
Yeah.
It is, but they've been chipping it as well.
Look at they've been chipping it.
It's not actually all that clean. You then have a nice little restaurant come bar type arrangement here with the set in furniture, so you can have it with or without, which
yes.
I like.
The colours are so funky.
What's good about this is to see all the overhangs and stuff in the different shapes.
Yeah.
What you tend to find is with the HDF stuff is it can look quite boxy.
The temptation is just to make a box with windows.
These Zen guys have done a good job on making it look all a bit more random.
Yeah.
Do you have any other angles of this?
No, this is all I have for this. Right.
Well, unfortunately, on this image, you can't really see the windows, but the windows are, let me bring it up big, over on the left, are really cool looking on some of the other images. You can really get a grasp of what they look like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, then, what else I have? They've actually done a little set of objective markers, which I really liked, which is these wee things with the gems inside them.
Yeah.
You know, so, yes, it's a box that's an objective, but it's really cleverly done because they've actually managed to put hinges into it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so the thing will flip open and close as you want it to. So it's not something you really see. And the last thing I've done is, this sort of feels like a military barracks type arrangement.
Yes, yeah. I was looking at this and I thought, ooh, is that HDF? Because it's really gribbly looking.
Yeah.
Really gribbly. You don't have the picture of this in HDF by any chance?
No, there was only one image of this that I saw.
Oh, damn. Well, on their site, if you go to them, visit their website.
Yeah, Zen Terrain.
Zen Terrain. Mm-hmm. You can actually see how this looks in its non-painted form. You look at it and go, I see how they did all the gribbly shapes and stuff.
Yeah.
They also do some vehicles. They've got like some manga type bikes, something similar to what you would find in Akira.
Yep.
Yeah.
The bikes are cool.
Yeah, and they've got like a little chopper helicopter jet thing.
Yeah, yes. That is really funky. You showed me that.
That reminds me of Gundam Unicorn.
It kind of reminds me more of, what was that movie with Tom Cruise? A futurist.
Oh, Oblivion?
Oblivion. It reminds me a little bit of Oblivion.
Fair enough.
Little design, but yeah. I like the helicopter.
It was a nice little touch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it'd been really cool if we'd had some pictures of them,
Wouldn't
Dustin.
It, Justin?
I can only do so much. I have been harried all day trying to get images for this show. Thank you.
I'll say it again. Can't get the staff.
Can't get the management.
Oh yeah, blame management.
But yeah,
always.
I'm enjoying that range.
Aye.
And it was a nice surprise for me this week. I've maybe seen it before, the company or something, but not really gone and visited through the range. At the minute, it's basically all sci-fi.
Yeah.
I see they're listing historical and fantasy, but there's nothing in those sections yet.
Yeah.
But it'll be interesting to see what they come up with for it.
Yeah. If you're on the hunt for some terrain, go and check them out. Have a wee browse. They've got some like cool communication towers and stuff like that.
Some of their watchtowers they had as well were
and the watchtowers. If only we'd had pictures of those.
Yeah, if we had pictures of those, Justin, that would have been good.
Yeah. Look at that face. Goodness sakes.
It's all your fault.
Can't get this done.
Moving on with terrain though.
Yes.
Yeah.
I didn't stop there. I did notice then that there was some pre-orders up from Foreground yesterday. Yep. For their Jezere product range. Now that's the stuff for Drop Zone Commander, essentially.
Yeah,
it's the 10mm stuff.
Yeah, so this.
Yes. We're just jump straight in there with the landing pad.
Yeah, which is one of the coolest parts of it.
Do we have anything else?
Of course we have other stuff. We have lovely little ridge fences.
Yeah. Which... Now the fences I like, you may look at it and go, it's just fences. But if you had to sit and make all of that at 10mm,
Yeah, 10mm, no thanks.
You will still have to build it when you get it, but if you had to make it from scratch, you'd be really sickened.
Yeah. And as this is, it gives you nice ways to actually cut up your board and make it look...
Yeah. Because along with road sections and stuff, they do a cool set of roads and stuff for this. That gives you something to put along it, because road in itself doesn't cut the board in half.
No. We see it lets you do sort of like quarantine and prison areas as well. You know, so you could actually do a Scourge prison camp from this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's a nice
idea. Well, it falls under the industrial zones.
Yeah.
They're thinking not prisons and stuff, they're thinking...
Yeah, but why couldn't you use it for that? You could actually make a Scourge prison camp.
Yes, you could, but they're thinking is industrial...
depots.
Industrial zones and things like that, said.
That's fair enough. Well, that's what sprung to mind for
me. Have we got the subways?
We do have the subways, which I think the Resistance are really going to like, because that's pretty much where all of them live these days.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Jezzery product range is really shaping up. If you browse around Foreground's website, you kind of just look at it and go, oh my goodness, I didn't even see them building up this big range.
Yeah.
It's only when you start browsing around it, looking at it all sitting there going, wow, they've been hard at work.
Yeah, they really have.
The Foreground guys are always surprising us. There's always something new coming out from them, just to amaze you.
And their modular road system's great. I'm going to probably talk about modular roads in the backstage edition of the show a bit, because it's not often you find... a company making a really good modular system. Roads are so heavily overlooked in Wargaming. Mm-hmm. But I will talk more about that in the backstage show. So that's just a few things that caught my eye. I think we're going to move on. Probably going to talk about some X-Wing.
Yep.
But for that, John, I'm going to kick you out of the show. I'm going to bring Chris in, because I know he's chomping at the bit to talk some X-Wing. So we're going to tell you about some hubs, and then we'll be right back.
It's time for 28mm World War II action. Will you recreate history or reshape it your way? On the Bolt Action Hub at beastsofwar.com. Venture into the dangerous dungeons of myth as a mighty hero and stand against the darkness. Visit the Myth Hub on beastsofwar.com and begin your story.
Welcome back, everyone. Time to talk a bit of X-Wing. Kristen.
Yep.
Force Awakens set. Oh!
I know, I'm looking forward to the movie. I mean, when the trailer came out, I was like, okay, actually, this does look pretty cool, you know? So I'm actually pretty excited now that X-Wing are getting the set
to
match.
What exactly is it they're doing here?
So they're matching the X-Wings and the TIEs.
Do you know the way you get a starter set?
Yeah, I'll get two TIEs, one X-Wing, yeah.
Now you can have the same starter set, essentially, but in the new style for the movie. So you get the new X-Wing, and you get the new style of TIEs.
Okay, now I understand.
Yeah.
And this is kind of exciting. Have we got a picture there?
I've got a picture of the box here.
So let me bring that up on the screen when it comes up.
I mean, anybody who's got the box before will see that this is pretty much the same box set, but just with alternate art, and the miniatures have alternate paint schemes on them.
And it's now blue.
Yes, because it matches in with the sort of the movie theme.
Yeah.
Now, what's big about this? The nothing big in so much as it is an identical starter set from what I gather. Yeah. You know, the rules will be the same.
Yeah.
The tokens will be the same.
Yeah, yeah.
The flight pass system will be the same. But we're getting new cards and stuff, obviously, for the new models.
Yeah, well, I mean, like this seems like something that's really just going to cash in for the new designs.
Oh, is it? What? I mean, this... Their Fantasy Flight's going to clean up with this December.
I have an image here I want you to see, because these are leaked images, but this is one I found online of the actual design of the new type of X-Wing.
Okay, but the ones in the box don't look like this. This is massive.
Yeah, this is something to show you what the new type of X-Wing is meant to look like.
Yeah. Yes. So this is what concept from the movie? Concepts, is it? From the movie?
I'm not exactly sure. I found it online. I know it's the correct design, and it looks fantastic.
Yeah, so the new stuff is the T-70 X-Wing.
Yeah.
Similar to the old X-Wing, except the wing splits in the middle now, rather than just flat.
Yeah, and the engine pods, instead of being full circles, are sort of a half circle.
You can see there, they're like semis.
It all joins together. Now, I'm excited to see them pushing on with this, because obviously now we're going to see loads more new ships once the new movies come out.
Yeah.
I mean, December 18th is excitement time!
Yeah.
It's when Force Awakens lands on us, and we get to see all the new ideas of all the ships that we can have. All the new characters that'll probably end up being made as miniatures with their other tabletop game. Yep. Pilots, cards, skills, all that.
Yeah. And an Imperial Assault too. The characters might go into something like Imperial Assault.
Exactly, Imperial Assault.
Or the bigger one, the Fleet Battles one that they do.
Yes.
They're bigger ships.
Star Wars Armada.
You might have some bigger ships thrown in there as well now.
Yeah.
Yeah, the interesting bit is, one of the things that interests me is if I play with, go back to, have we got other images? Get the X-Wing up with its cards.
Yeah, I believe this is it.
If I field the new X-Wing.
No, that's the tie.
Well, that'll do. No, okay, we'll go to the X-Wing.
we'll go to the X-Wing.
If I field the new X-Wing, the T-70, will I be able to play that along with my old X-Wings and stuff?
I don't know.
Or is this going to end up like, you know, Flames of War and Bolt Action, late war, early war? I mean,
are the stats different?
Yes.
That's the question.
No, the stats here you can see they're different now.
Well, let me bring that up. Okay.
The most notable stats, I'll point out, is they have an extra shield.
Uh-huh.
Okay. They're slightly more expensive because they've got these extra little things. So they've got plus one shield, from what I can tell, and they have an extra equipment slots.
Yes.
In their thing.
Now I have one of the original cards here for the normal X-Wing. I'll just bring that up under the close cam, and you can get a view at it. Let me just get that in the shot. So
what's the name on this one?
This is just a regular X-Wing.
What's the actual name on it? I'm trying to figure out one.
That's
to the
just
other.
A Red Squadron pilot.
So that's in the top right one there. Is...
Wait. Let me just concentrate on the card first.
Yeah.
Right. So here's your regular X-Wing.
Yeah.
Just a Red Squadron pilot, level 4.
Uh huh.
Two shields.
Mm-hmm.
And two abilities.
Right.
And not too many options down here, just the two options.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if we go to the new stuff, you will see that, see the regular squadron veteran or whatever it is, can't quite read it.
In the top right.
Whose pilot skill 4 now has 3 shields,
mm-hmm.
more maneuverability options, and more upgrade options.
Yeah.
He's slightly more expensive at 26, whereas a regular X-Wing used to be 23 at pilot skill 4.
Well, I think 3 points. For what you're getting, I mean, if you count those equivalent upgrades, like a shield upgrade is, I think it's 3 points on its own.
Okay.
Just to get plus one shield, so you're basically getting 2 free upgrades.
So I think the thinking here is they're in the future, therefore the ship's got better.
Yeah.
Because if we go to the picture of the TIE fighter,
if we go to that.
Now, TIE fighters were never really good in X-Wing.
No, like, they were
good in swarm.
They were
tactics.
Chucked out.
Yeah.
You were cannon fodder essentially. Yeah. Now it's called the TIE FO, I believe. Looking at the pictures, is it FD or FO? Let me bring that up.
Yeah,
I think it says FO.
FO, it says.
Yeah.
But what you'll notice is all those TIE fighters now have a shield.
Mm.
Whereas they didn't before. They had no shields
that
at all.
That is actually amazing. I was like...
TIE fighters with shields!
Because I looked at them and said, they're not that different. And I kind of like looked away, looked back and went, whoa, wait a minute.
They haven't just turned black. They've got shields as well.
Well, hang on. Right, you guys know how to play X-Wing. I'm a bit of a novice at this.
Yes.
What is the difference between this and the original, then?
Well, basically...
Well, let me show you the card, right? So I have the card in front of me for the TIEs. Now, this is just basically a sort of a standard pilot.
Yeah.
If I can get it there.
So,
right?
Still
three. So, notably, no shields.
Yeah.
Notably, no upgrades whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
And it has focus, barrel roll, and...
Evasion.
Okay.
Yeah.
But if I go to the new cards, you'll see now it has a shield.
Yeah.
Now it's just one shield, but it's a shield nonetheless, which shows the TIEs are getting better.
Yeah.
But notice they all have upgrade options now.
Mm. Yeah.
Whereas that TIE I just showed you had none. And they also have focus.
Right.
Sorry, not focus, target lock.
Yeah.
Whereas that regular TIE I just showed you didn't have
and
target lock.
And they have astromech upgrades.
Where? Yes, they have.
So they can take astromix.
Yes.
Which is quite good.
Right, quick question. For the function of shields, if it gets taken away, can you regenerate that?
No.
No?
Okay. Not really. It's just, it's basically a free...
If you have an astro droid, you can do that.
You can.
Okay.
Like
okay.
R2-D2 and stuff can
regenerate shields. Another dig.
Or BB-8. He's in the cards. I've seen a picture of a card with BB-8.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, like I said, these are leaks, so they're really, really blurry.
As far as I'm aware, BB-8 is not an astromech droid.
No,
in the movie.
I don't know.
The
first
time
I
saw him, I thought it was a bloody Adidas advert.
So, I'm not sure how he's going to fit, but, you know, I like that he's there, obviously, because he's pretty cool.
All the new stuff is going to make its way in. That's what you can guarantee. This is now a cash cow for Fantasy Flight. They are going to be making and making and making stuff in this for years to come.
Well, I'm excited for it, because it's a new... I've been off X-Wing with other things, and now I'm glad that I can jump back in with, like, this new... era of it, you know?
But it's going to be cool. There are, people will be looking at it and going, you're finally getting ships that will recognize because they'll watch it in the movies.
Yep.
Now, on one of the previous Weekenders, I believe I was talking about this. There was new ships coming out that we'd never seen in the movies, and I thought that was even more exciting.
Yeah.
finding ships that you'd never seen before and then trying to figure out, oh, what does that do?
But you see, I would have been looking at that going, is that maybe going to be in the new movies?
It may well, they may well be in the new movies.
You know, that's the other thing, because...
Now, the other thing I've been trying to work out is the TIE an actually a different model? Or is it the same model, just in a black color? But looking closely at it, I kind of think it's...
It looks 90, like there's some upgrades to
90-odd% the same.
Yeah, but even the X-Wing, it's more stylistic design changes that you're seeing.
Yeah.
There is a Hasbro, like, they've brought out a really big version.
Yeah. Of the X-Wing?
No, the TIE Fighter. And it has these weird pods on the side. If I'm mistaken, don't crucify me, they do look like a regular TIE Fighter, but in black with white wings.
Well, yeah, I mean, they're just an alternate, you know, this is what? 20 years, isn't it?
So if you want to upgrade your TIE Fighters, you can basically just spray them black and paint the wings white.
Yeah.
Why would you do that?
Well, then, I don't know. No, I'm
willing to
bet
there are some subtle changes to
it. I'm hoping you can play them all together. I can field regular TIEs with the new modern TIEs and so on.
Even if you could just say, relics of the past sort of thing, you know, they're still...
But it's all still on the same points value, so there's no reason you can't.
I'm hoping that's the case, and that I don't see why it wouldn't be the case. I really wouldn't like a period line drawn through X-Wing saying that's pre-Force Awakens and this is Force Awakens.
Pre-Disney. Well, maybe if you're doing, say, like a historic... Battle it from a movie or something.
Are we talking about historical? Historical
X-Wing. Why
is John not here right now so we can watch him Twitch at this on camera?
You know what I mean? Like, if you're doing one based on the movies, the previous movies where these weren't in it, then you probably wouldn't.
If you run a themed campaign or something where you're actually working your way through the movies and the space battles from the movies.
Yeah, and then you
might
go
be
on.
A cool way to do
I like that.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's cool looking stuff. I can't wait to get a set of this in. Mm. I will probably just grab the miniatures and run off and go whizzing around the room because the rest of the box set probably is the same. If it's not, then I'll be good. That'll be a good surprise to open it up and go, oh, this is different.
I hope the kind of like measuring stuff's just a little different so that you can have differentiation between like two players, you know.
The one thing I wonder is, will we see this make its way onto the high street again? Because I know the first incarnation of this made it into the high street here in Korean.
Star Wars, December 18th.
Yeah, I'm wondering...
If X-Wing made it into...
Will I walk into my local Waterstones and see this?
If X-Wing made it into Waterstones...
It did.
I know it did. Let me finish my statement. If X-Wing made it into Waterstones with no movie to back it up, what do you think the new set's going to do?
I think you're wrong. I think the original X-Wing had, what, 6 movies to back it up?
No, a current release at
I know,
that point.
This one,
it wouldn't surprise me if it ended up in flipping Tesco.
September 4th? Is like a massive release for Star Wars.
Yes, when all the Hasbro
stuff and there's apparently about 20 different things coming out on September 4th for like
How many people Star do you Wars think stuff? Will buy 3 of each? One to play with, the rest to put in the attic.
I don't think it'd be worth any money because everyone will put
them
in
the attic. No, these aren't so collectible. Not so much.
I don't know.
You'll get people that'll think, nah, it'll never happen this time, and then it'll happen. They'll go, oh, why did I open my Chewbacca?
I guess people who were buying them back in the day when the first movies came out probably didn't think, oh, these will be worth anything.
Maybe.
Don't get me started on my horror stories of having all my Star Wars given
you've
away.
You've told us.
All the Star Wars given away.
We have commiserated with you many a time on this.
Anyway,
subject.
September 4th, there's a big sort of like Hasbro release.
Yeah.
I'm not sure when this box set's coming out.
No, I'm not sure either.
So if you know, put it in the comments below. But it wouldn't surprise me if it was around the same sort of time period.
Yeah, only September 4th or towards the movie.
Oh, everyone's getting
excited.
It's
not excited. Too long.
I just have
images of Lloyd and him standing in the queue, trying to cut the queue by running up the side with their X-Wing mini. Yeah. Dogfighting and then jumping out at the front of the queue.
There's a bit of a campaign system you're playing. We're not talking about now. We're going to talk about
later on.
In backstage, we're going to talk about an
X-Wing campaign
system.
Backstage, I'll talk about a campaign system. You were saying about campaign system. Maybe these could jump into the campaign system. So later on, I'll talk about that.
Yeah.
That we're doing.
Very cool stuff. Right now, there's a bit of a Kickstarter. I believe it's a Kickstarter that's caught you guys' attention.
It hooked my attention earlier. This one really caught my attention. It's a horror survival board game called Lobotomy.
Yeah,
right. It's very dark. It's very, very gritty, but it lets you see the world through the eyes of madness of the patients that you're playing in the game. It's absolutely brilliant. Cool. I love the look of it.
Do we have a picture of the box or anything?
Yes, I have a picture of the box. So if this decides to work, yes, hooray.
Ooh,
so,
this is looking cool.
Yeah.
Let me bring that up for everyone.
So it's a modular board. So you'll start off with that central square tile.
Yes.
So that's a solitary confinement wing of the insane asylum.
Right, so I'm a nutter in an asylum, essentially. Yep.
Yes, and you're seeing the world through the eyes of this poor insane person.
Yeah, I see this game's coming from Titanforge Games.
Yeah. They're the guys that did X-Terra, if you remember it.
Ooh,
so that was
yes.
those nice sci-fi troopers, vehicles, and demons.
Because I was sitting here thinking, that Titanforge game sounds very familiar. Of course, yes. Now I don't realize why.
Yeah, but the lovely thing about this is, with it being a modular board, you have multiple missions, so you've got a lot of replayability in this.
Yeah.
So you slot one section out, new one goes in, you have a new mission on that, which is really cool.
Do we have a bigger picture of the board itself?
Possibly. Let me have a look. We have a bigger picture of the board here.
Yes.
So we have a nice close-up of it.
So ooh, that's nice.
This is what the Insane Asylum looks like inside. You can see you've got your overlord up in the top right corner here. He's the guy in charge of the Insane Asylum. You've got some of the gribbly monsters and stuff, and you've got your characters in red here.
Yeah.
Now, the interesting thing about this is, although they're all monsters and it looks wrecked, that isn't actually what it is in reality. These people are just viewing it because they're all mentally insane.
Ah, so it's not like Cthulhu or something, and it's full of monsters.
No.
Well,
I was thinking sort of monsters or mansions of monsters or something.
Mansions of madness.
That's the one. That's the one.
No, there is an insanity mechanic in this, but the key is, even though I might be fighting some big nasty gribbly, it might just be an orderly, another patient, or a potted plant.
Yeah.
Cool, do we have pictures of these?
We have pictures of all the monsters and stuff, which are really nicely sculpted and detailed.
So, if I bring these up, you're telling me that, say, that guy, that construct over there, he could just be a regular porter.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, he could just be one of the orderlies.
Because I am actually nuts in this game.
And you view them, obviously, in a negative light, because they're the ones who are keeping you, you know, in solitary confinement, in your room, trying to inject you with stuff, and you just think, oh no!
Exactly, and that transfers on to item gathering and stuff, because you have character progression in this, where you pick up new weapons and things. So you're starting off with basic stuff, but if you go searching and looting, you have to do what they call an imagination roll. So, depending on how well you roll, depends on how good of weapon you get.
Yeah.
But you just think it's that good a weapon. So I could think I have the ultimate sword of beast slaying.
Oh, that's nice.
No, it's just my crutch.
That's nice. I like the way they've taken the madness to that.
Mm. Yeah.
I wander around with a balloon. I'm going to stab you with a balloon.
Yes, whereas what you really believe it is, this is the mace of destruction.
Now, another dynamic you'll notice with like some of the bad guys, and especially the heroes when you see them, because they say, you know, the mind is a complicated thing, but it gets lazy, especially when it's sick.
Mm-hmm.
So they basically fill in the gaps of things that they can't remember or, you know, their imagination takes over. So you'll notice that a lot of the characters, a lot of the bad guys, a lot of the environments, a lot of the weapons are movie related or, you know, something related to TV shows, books, something.
Yeah, there's a lot of cameos in there.
Oh, that's really cool. So even the environments aren't real?
No. Yeah. They're real in the sense that they are in the same sound, but they will view them, say, as a scene from, you know, some movie that they've seen, be it, you know, the Alien movies or John Constantine or something like that. They'll view it like that because that would say a movie that they've seen and they just fill in the gaps. Their insanity fills in the gaps.
Mm. Well, you see, the fun thing is it's a very expandable game because you can play it from one player to six or more.
Yeah. Ooh, that's nice.
So it's not even, if I buy this, I have to get my mates into it. No, I can buy this, I can learn it.
Wait a minute.
And then I can get my mates into it.
You said one player. Can you play this on your own?
Yes. One to six players or more.
I'm guessing that this is a cooperative game then, because it's you versus the system.
Yeah, it's you versus the system. It's basically each of the quadrants on the game board gives you a mission.
Yeah, let's go back to looking at the game board.
So, okay, if I go to the very big image of it, which
that's
is here. In the actual game board, you have quadrants, which are slotting in. So you can see at the top of this, you've got the central, and then this quadrant here.
Yeah, let me bring that up.
Got a mission for it.
Yeah. Now, what I like about this is I've come to really like board games that don't necessarily have little one-inch squares.
Mm.
Yeah.
That like this have lines designating basically whole chunks of rooms and stuff.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's a bit like that Conan game. I like that. I'm really getting into that system.
Well, it makes the thing look a little more insane, and your movement feels a little more juddery because they're all different shapes and sizes, which I quite like.
Now, we've talked about the characters. We got pictures of the actual red characters.
Yeah, I have a nice big image of the characters, and we've also got some of the items and stuff that you get here as well as the neuroses that they have to deal with.
Yeah.
You've got things like schizophrenia, OCD, anxiety, neuroses, and aggression.
Yes.
Those generate your abilities through the game.
Because each character has their own unique set of mental, you know, illness.
Issues, yes.
You know, that's kind of cool. If I've got... What do I get, though, if I've, like, OCD? Do I think, get better ability to find things
because I'm obsessive?
Yeah, it's things like that, you know. So it basically builds up your abilities, what you can do through the game, and depending on what you have, it changes. You've also got your equipment, your meds, and your weapons.
Yes.
So I don't exactly know how the meds are going to work. It's probably just you can heal yourself. You've got weapons, you know, bloody pair of scissors, equipment keys if I need to get out of my room.
Yeah.
You know, it's very, very nice.
But this guy here, the muscly one, do we have an image or anything of that?
Well, we have his character card if you want to see it.
Perfect. That's what I'd like to see, yeah.
Exactly. So this is Arnie.
Arnie. He's literally called Arnie. Let's bring him up.
He is Arnie. Yeah. But he's got aggression and anxiety, and his starting equipment is a wooden cross. You know, so you start off very basic, and then you've got all your different stat lines. So you've got the green arrow, which is the number of actions you can perform. You've got the blood, which is obviously damage. You've got your fight skill, your defense skill. And the little light bulb is your imagination, which is how creative you can be whenever you're picking up items and stuff.
Yeah, it probably helps you imagine just how the environments and stuff. I would assume the more creative you are, the more nuts you might be.
Yeah, it's the more likely you are to get like a really good weapon because you're more likely to imagine something as being something else.
I also see there's a brain here. I think this is some sort of reference to your insanity level.
This is what tracks your insanity. Now, I've got a bigger version of this. So basically what you're looking at here is you'll start on your insanity, and as you go up, you can start to get some bonuses for being more and more doolally, if you want to put it that way. You know, which I think is really, really nice. So it says plus one CD, plus two CD.
Yes.
So you are getting bonuses. But the fun thing is, if you die in this game, you don't die.
What?
If you die...
Yeah, I got that.
You don't die.
What?
What happens is, you get dragged by the orderlies back to solitary confinement.
Yes.
And strapped in, shot up with meds, and you become a little more sane. And then you start again. The problem is, it moves forward sort of the doomsday counter, which is meeting the Overseer, which is that big demon-y guy.
Yeah, do we have a picture of him?
Yeah, I've got a nice piece of artwork for him.
Now, this Overseer guy, he's just the guy who runs the asylum.
Yeah, this would be the chief administrator of the hospital.
But through the mentally insane people's eyes, he looks
a demon!
Like
He's the ultimate, you know, bad guy in this place. He's the one who put you here. He's the one who controls all the lesser guys. He is the one that you need to beat at the end of the game.
Because normally, if you take, like, Mansions of Madness and stuff like that, it is actually bad creatures and stuff.
Yeah.
Whereas I really kind of dig in this idea that I'm just fighting regular people and I'm just an otter.
Or potted plants, or
you keep
a door,
saying potted plants. Is there actually... Yes. Am I going to try and fight a potted plant in this game?
No. Yeah, well, basically, you are fighting the monster. You are imagining the monster. But in reality, you're just in a corner mumbling and grumbling at a potted plant.
Don't you see that again? They think it's a big tentacle monster or something. You know,
that's the real fun of it. It's showing you this world through the eyes of insanity, which I absolutely love.
Yeah. That idea that it's not real, but you know it's not real, but your character doesn't. It's kind of cool. You want to get more insane. It's cool.
There is one thing I will say. This is on Kickstarter.
Yes.
And it's coming to the end.
Yes.
Because as of filming, there are 3 days left for this.
Mm-hmm. That means it'll be finishing tomorrow.
2 or 1 day left on it.
Yeah. When is it finished? Is it Sunday?
It says 3 days.
Oh, Monday.
Monday.
Yeah. So Monday, August 31st.
A lot of time to get into that if you're interested in it.
And it is one that's definitely worth getting in on, I think.
Yeah. Especially,
what do you think yourself, Lloyd?
I'm liking the look of it. Let's go back to the picture with the box and the actual
board layout. Yeah, sure.
Because I want to get another look at that.
There you go.
There's a lot of cards
looks like
going
a,
on,
looks like
it?
A quality production, because when I think Titanforge games, I think miniatures and stuff. I don't normally think, you know, laid out board game and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I mean, like, for me, whenever I think Titanforge, the X-Terra stuff really hooked me. It was a beautifully designed set of miniatures because you had the nice, clean sci-fi troopers. Yeah.
But now,
the dark and
now they've got really cool artwork and stuff on cards, and even the box looks really cool.
Exactly. Yeah.
Exactly.
I'm kind of looking forward to that. Mm. Are you guys tempted to jump on that Kickstarter then?
Well, I've been Crystal saying to him, let's go half.
Need to go half, so he's on it.
But he doesn't want to. He wants one of his own, you know. I want to get it
after the Kickstarter, because these games need support beyond a Kickstarter.
Yes.
Yes, I won't get all the cool free stuff, but I know that then it's in production, it's done and dusted.
Well, I'm interested because I don't want... Well, you know, I do obviously just want the basic box, but because of all these stretch goals now, because it's... They've pretty much hit every single stretch goal.
I think there's two left, isn't there?
There's two left now, that last time I looked. Mm. And there are some that I really want. There's Black Eye Children, which is me and Sam's big thing. We love Black Eye Children.
What is a Black Eye? What are Black Eye Children?
They're like these little children that come to your door and they'll knock on your door and they'll say, let us in. And they'll say for something really bog standard, like we need some salt or a drink or we need to use your phone. But if you let them in, apparently...
I believe these come from some form of damned village.
Yeah. But anyway, so there's Black Eyed Children who are really creepy. Children always freak me out. Mm. You know, zombies, whatever. But little children...
How can they freak you out? You're like the closest to the child in here that we have.
I know, but I just children freak me out. Also, a big one is the From the Deep expansion, which is a big expansion for it, which pretty much just changes it to Call of Cthulhu.
Yeah, basically someone dropped the Necronomicon down in the library one day.
Yeah.
So the monsters actually become real monsters at that
point? Yeah, you get like deep ones and you get, I can't remember what they call Cthulhu, but it's Cthulhu, you know. So you get that. That's a big expansion because that kind of changes a lot of the dynamics of it. Because you get a new boss. Instead of the administrator, you get Cthulhu.
Yeah. You also get Doctor Who-esque sort of miniatures in there. So you have silent angels and stuff like that, which are quite cool.
Yeah.
Silent angels are kind of creepy. Speaking of creepy, go back to the monsters.
Okay, the monsters
There's
themselves.
One in particular that sort of stands out a bit.
Yeah, which one?
It's like this little guy here. Look at that creepy little guy.
That's no one important. That's the Antichrist.
Yeah. What? Like...
As in the
Antichrist.
Yes, as in Son of the Devil.
This is what we mean. There's movie references in there.
Yeah, so it's a movie reference. And then obviously the construct is like a Frankenstein reference.
Yeah, so there's Frankenstein and
exactly. There's lots of sort of cameos in here. So
This guy looked kind of familiar. There is a movie called Legend, I think it is, that has a big horny guy in it.
Yeah, and he's kind of just generic.
It's like Kristen said, you know, these people have access to modern-day media, and the insanity is just going, oh my God, they're all around me!
I've done that now, and I just know Dead Days.
Yeah,
like he's prime opportunity.
Yeah,
trust me, that man needs to find a different hobby.
It is looking really, really cool.
Mm-hmm. I'm really impressed with it. It's one definitely to check out.
Yeah, I mean, the whole story is what's got me, you know. I like the gameplay, I like that, but it's just this background that I'm just absolutely loving me, keeping me
into this. You're also going to have the RPG elements in this game.
Yeah.
Because I know if I sit down to play with this with Warren, he's going to start telling stories and stuff.
He's going to turn into, like, some sort of, you know, aquatic, you know, meat-eating monster of some kind.
I'm just gonna rhyme off some of the stuff here that I've got in front of me. So we've covered dedicated 1-6 players, but more can play. Cooperative horror adventure.
Yep.
Character development. I like the idea of developing my insanity levels.
Yeah, and your actual equipment and gear.
Yep.
Unique dungeon crawling roguelike mechanics and solo play option.
Yeah, I like the fact there's a solo play option. It lets you learn the game before you take it to your mates.
Yep.
Replayability with a modular game board. Yep. Random scenarios and different narrative every playthrough.
Yep.
As we've seen, we've had a good look at the game board. Ability to win the game by losing your mind in the process.
Yes.
That's excellent.
You kind of want to lose. Winning is losing. Zero. It's kind of cool.
Let's see, 40 highly detailed miniatures and monsters inspired by the classic horror themes. Now, go back to the picture of the whole layout. I don't think it shows all the miniatures, it's mostly all the cards and things.
Yes, and
there is a lot of miniatures.
There is a lot of miniatures there. I don't know if that's 40, but 40 is quite a lot of miniatures.
Then that's not even including all the stretch goals and stuff that are coming along with this as well.
Well, yeah, if you do go and visit the actual Kickstarter page, did we bring the... we'll bring that
back
up.
Yeah, we did bring this up.
You will see there is an absolute mountain of stretch goals that's been unlocked.
Yeah, immense.
And you can see at the time of filming, they've already got like 284,000, so it's a well-funded game.
Yes,
exactly.
A very short time left to get in on it if you're interested.
We see, I love this tagline down the bottom. Escape Mental Asylum in Lobotomy Board Game. Got monsters on your back, mighty weapons, blazing skills, or just delusions?
Yeah. Just delusions. Going through it, at least 5 player characters.
Yeah.
At least 5 different player characters, each with personalized miniature backstory on set.
So yeah. That's like in the main set, you get the five, and then in the stretch goals, there's other bonuses. Cards.
Oh, yeah, that's what I mean by at least five.
Yeah, because there's, I think, five stretch goal characters now.
Mm. Equipment, skill cards collected, actions, decisions, RPG elements. It does sound really cool. And the thing about these sorts of games is I'm really coming around to playing more board games. Mm. Yeah. You know, we talked a lot about dungeon delving on the XLBS show last week. There wasn't a public weekender last week, but there was an XLBS show. If you've missed it, we have a 7-day free trial. You can jump in and you can watch last week's show all about dungeon delving.
Yeah. Yeah.
But all of that's put me in the mood for playing games like this.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they're self-contained, is what I love about it.
Because dungeon delving isn't just dungeons. Here we can see it's about an asylum, it's about creepy houses.
You think it's a dungeon even if you wanted to.
Well, it actually says it's a dungeon crawler. The actual game type they're giving it is dungeon crawler.
Excellent, excellent stuff.
Yeah.
Right, I'm going to move us on.
Right.
Because we've got prizes to announce.
Winners!
We've got quite a lot of prizes to announce.
Yeah.
Now, the first ones we've got are from a weekender a couple of weeks ago, and they're Kings of War related. What is this, Justin?
This was when we had Rich from Mantic over. So we had five prizes up for grabs. We had the first place prize, which was one of the 50 quid starter armies of the winner's choice, and a Gamer's Edition rulebook. We also gave away four copies of the Gamer's Edition rulebook. So we have the winners chosen.
Uh-huh.
And just to be mean, I'm going to read the winners for the Gamer's Edition rulebook first.
Okay.
So the Here first winner... is Andrew Page from YouTube. You've won a rulebook.
Woo! Johnny dancing!
Yep. We then have Martin Hawk from Facebook. You've won a rulebook. We then have Silver Stars from Beast of War. Rulebook. And the last one we have Ava Jacob from Facebook. I'll put these in the show notes just so that people can actually see themselves, okay?
Cool. Now what you guys need to do is if you're watching the show, you need to come on over to beastofwar.com. Mm-hmm. Up in the top navigation, you'll find a link to a claims, a prize claims form. Yep. We need you to fill that out since we have all the details to then send you your prizes or get Mantic actually to send you your prizes.
Yeah. Yep.
We'll believe we have another one.
We have the top prize winner who won that.
Yeah.
50 quid starter army.
Amazing.
And Gamers Edition rulebook.
Do we want another drum roll? Go on, Kristen. You know you want to.
The winner is... The Niffing.
What?
The Niffing.
The Niffing? That's odd, a weird name.
Odd little name. Again, it'll be in the show notes if you're not sure it's you.
All right, see you at the end.
On Beast of War.
The Niffrig.
The Niffrig. Ah, that's it. The Niffrig.
Niffrig.
That sounds just as weird again.
Yeah. Again, it'll be in the show notes with the notation beside what you won.
The Niffrig. Now someone who is the Niffing's at home going, no!
Yeah, they're like, yes! Oh, no!
Apologies. Right. We have one more prize to give away.
Excellent. Is it another Mantic prize, Benny Chance?
It is another Mantic prize, but this is the one that I think a lot of people were really, really gunning for.
Okay.
Yeah. The winner
Drum
of
roll.
This... No, hang on. The winner of this competition was going to win a copy of Dungeon Saga and The Adventurer's Companion from Mantic Games.
Drum roll.
The winner is...
Pause for effect. Not that
Aussie
long.
Aussie UK.
Aussie UK.
Woo! Congratulations.
I bet he's excited. That is a good
Aussie
prize,
UK though. From Beast of War.
So we have about half a dozen people at home doing the jammy dance. Lloyd's personalised, copyrighted jammy dance.
Yeah, I've got a horrible image in my mind now.
What?
It's basically like the Colgate ad, except there's loads of people dancing in their jammies.
Okay.
Right.
That is kind of weird. Right, with that, fellas, ladies and gents, I'm going to wrap the show. We'll be back tomorrow for the XLBS. I'll have Kristen back, I'll have Justin back, and I'll have John. If you're interested in coming over and watching the XLBS, we have a 7-day free trial that you can take on Beast of War. If you take the 7-day free trial, don't cancel straight away because it will lock you out straight away. You would want to stay till, say, day 6 and then cancel then if you're not enjoying it. But I can't see why you wouldn't enjoy it because we have loads of content in Backstage. It's not just the XLBS show of the weekend. There's lots of different XLBS shows. Yep.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, you've got all of our painting tutorials are in there. All of our hobby labs are in there. You've got a ton of gaming stuff. You've got all the plugs. There's a mountain of stuff to work through in the Backstage. It's definitely worth having a look beyond just coming across and watching us on a Sunday going a little bit nutty.
Yeah, a great example is every Friday we've got like little videos going out for gaming. For example, let's take Drop Tactics, for example. That's a show where Simon from Hawk War Games came over and he shows off in every episode how to use a particular unit to the best effect. But then in the Backstage XLBS show, he'll show how to counteract that particular unit being worn or being used.
Right, so if your mate has sat down to watch the front stage show and goes, aha, I have a sneaky tactic to beat you, if you're a backstager,
you can watch the counter tactic and go, nah,
I've got you. Anyway, hopefully that's plucked your interest and you'll come over and watch the XLBS show tomorrow. Other than that, have a great weekend's gaming, everyone.
Fight for the Iron Kingdoms as a Warcaster. Take control of the mighty Jacks, arcane devices, and dark sorceries to bring the fight to the War Machine Hub on beastofwar.com. Anime cyberpunk style meets skirmish combat in Infinity. Experience 8 high-tech factions and fight to control the human sphere at the Infinity Hub on beastofwar.com.